Good evening. Welcome to The Focus. Mr. Riley, what's going on this evening?
Hey, what's going on, fellas? How y'all doing?
Everybody's good, man. Everybody's good. So, Cardell, you told me that you hit Cardell. Pretty much it got back to me with your original message about how we were going to start tonight's show. So, without further ado, Mr. Riley, out there in Chicago, the floor is yours.
Well, if this is an article, I would simply title it "The Rest of the NBA Season." It's becoming ridiculous. Resting guys this early into the season. I'm talking, and they were resting people earlier than this, if I'm not mistaken. And we're talking about stars. And it's becoming an issue because there's two sides of it. There's people saying this is a grueling 82-game season, and then there's people saying, well, you're disappointing fans that are buying these tickets, these high-priced tickets at that. And for the NBA to have this model, the NBA cares, and they go out to the neighborhoods, and they fix up the houses, and they give back to the community, they obviously don't care about their pockets. Because if I'm a fan, and I'm paying $300-$400 for three tickets, for me, my son, and my daughter to come out and see these guys play, they're not playing, and I don't find out until that day that they're not playing, I'm pretty upset. I'm pretty pissed off. And it doesn't seem like the NBA is doing a whole lot about it. Now, I just read an article where Adam Silver, he apparently sent out a memo to the owners of the NBA saying this is going to be something that they're going to discuss, because I'm sure it's hit his desk and it's becoming what he called a significant issue. Because you can't keep talking about this and not do anything about it. There has to be some type of action. Something has to happen in order for these teams to stop doing it. And I'm not saying don't rest guys, but I'm saying you can't rest three of your stars on one team for one night. Like, that's just ridiculous. And we're talking about March 18th is when this happened. And it was happening before that. And for some reason, teams think it's okay. Well, we're worried about championships. Well, they've been worried about championships for years. This is nothing new. It's always been an 82-game season, as far as I know. So the length of the season is not, it is like it's anything new. So something else needs to happen in order for this to stop happening. Maybe you got to start hurting these guys' pockets. Maybe you got to change some practice schedules. Maybe you have to look at the minutes that are being played. And, you know, some games on those back-to-backs, that first game, maybe that guy only needs to play 20, 25 minutes, and then the next game around, that's where you play him more. Closer to the 30, 35-minute mark. But something has to be done because it is becoming an issue. It's hard to watch these games when you don't have your stars playing. Nobody wants to see Golden State without Stephen Curry, Klay Thompson, Andre Iguodala, Kevin Durant, and whoever else it was that they set out. Nobody really wants to see that because San Antonio's going to dog walk them, which is what they did. Nobody wants to see the Clippers and the Cleveland Cavaliers without LeBron, without Kyrie, without Kevin Love. But it has to stop. It's changing the way the NBA is viewed. I mean, they just started to find their way back into the good graces of people, and now you start to, you know, stir the pot again with resting players this early in the season, and you're telling fans, well, it's about championships. It's not about what you want to watch. Well, that's a bad look. So I got a little attitude about it. I'm kind of protesting the NBA the next 2 days, just the next two, until the tournaments start back up and everything's going to go back to normal. But I just wanted to get that off my chest real quick. So I don't know what you guys' thoughts on this. Well, I kind of know what Cardell's thoughts are a little bit. You know what I'm saying? But I'm curious as to what you guys think about this.
All right. Well, Rob, we're going to go ahead and let these fine people here discuss it a little bit. Thank you so much for calling in. And, yes, we can tell you have an attitude. And, wow, a 48-hour protest.
Mm. It ain't going to last long. I mean, let's not be unreasonable. Still got to keep up with everything. I'm just making a point.
Hey, look, at least you were honest about it. Appreciate it, Rob.
Right.
Talk to you next
All
week.
Right, y'all have a good night.
All right, so before we go to break, you guys want to offer any quick insights to this resting issue? Because that's all anybody's been talking about. Octavia?
Yeah, I definitely agree. I think we talked about this before. I don't like it either. I mean, I get it as far as, you know, they're humans. Of course, they get tired. But you get paid millions and millions and millions of dollars to play a game that you claim that you love so much. And I mean, it goes back to, like you said, the model for the NBA is NBA cares. You know, if you're not caring about your fans, there's not going to be a league, you know. And like you said, people that are paying a lot of money, you know, that one game, I think it was between the Cavs and the Warriors, where people paid like $5,000 for floor seats. I mean, like people are paying bank to come see these games. And then you get there and they're like, oh, yeah, we're not playing because we're tired. And just like you said, it's like it's always been an 82-game season. It's definitely something they need to look into. I don't know if they, you know, you think about it, do they stretch the season out longer to have less back-to-backs? Like, what do you do? So I'm glad that they're at least addressing it now. It's all everybody's talking about. LeBron that came out was like, I mean, it's pretty much nothing y'all can do if I want to rest. I was like, okay, I'm pretty sure they'll find something. But, I mean, it's a catch-22. It's hard for both parties, but you got to look at the bigger picture.
Travis?
I mean, I agree. You know, I mean, I'm not a fan of it. You know, especially the way the league is now. Then, like you're saying, you have these people that come out, kids that come out that want to see their star players or their favorite players play, and they get there. Or people make. I think I saw a story where a family drove or came a long distance, and then the player wasn't even playing. You know, so it was a waste of money. And then I'm pretty sure they're disappointed, and that could have been their first game. You know, so it probably ruined their moment, and they probably wouldn't want to do it again, you know. So it's something definitely the league has to look into. And then, you know, about players resting, I get that players are tired, but like you said, that's something they have to look into as far as maybe stretching the season or less games. Or I mean, I don't know, because if you having players rest all the time, then, you know, I know San Antonio was doing it for one point in time, so I think everybody kind of wanted to follow their lead. But I think Popovich did it in a way where it was kind of like sort of reasonable, but now everybody's doing it. So it's like, you know, I don't know, it's interesting, you know.
Cardell.
My take on it is, if it's good for Wilt, Russell, Kareem, Magic, Bird, Jordan, I don't want to hear none of these dudes' mouths, man. Just straight up. And the fact is, you wrestling, you claiming it's for championship purposes. There's no theory proving that if you rest, you're going to win a championship. You know, so that's BS. That's just you wanting to sit out and collect the check. Like, I'm like, cool, you want to sit out, they need to take the check and find a team the same amount. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, LeBron might be making money and everything like that, but, you know, I read a Phil Jackson quote where he's saying, you make a lot of money, but $50,000 is $50,000. If you take $50,000, you're going to notice that not in your bank. You're like, hold on. And, you know, so if you tired, just you know,
$5.
Exactly. So if you tired, man, we understand LeBron will play a lot of mileage. You know, Kevin Love's coming off a lot of injuries. Kyrie, you still owe games from Duke. I don't even want to hear it. You like, what, 20? I'm not even trying to hear all that, man. So you still owe people games, man. I know Coach K, like, hold on, dog. Like, so bottom line is, get out there and play, man. Less than the minutes. That's all you got to do, man. You're just 25 to 30. And if you handle business like you should, like how the Warriors were last year, blow them out, sit most of the second half. Then, you know, you get in the rest. So I'm like, it's just excuses. It's just, you know, we become a shortcut coach, and it's affecting the league. And what they got to be careful of is everything trickles down from the NBA. Whatever standard the NBA sets, comes down to college, high school, AAU. Next thing you know, you're going to have AAU. Like, you know, we came up the same age. AAU and stuff, you playing four or five games a day. You see what I'm saying? So now you gonna have kids like, man, I gotta sit out three of them games, man. My knees hurt. Like, what? You want the scholarship? That's what's gonna end up happening.
That's
so come
and
on,
that's
man.
True though, like you said, man. You know, definitely is the NBA set the stage. You know, that's why I talk to a lot of guys, or I try to emphasize how they carry themselves and how they conduct themselves, because they're role models, right? Whether they want to be or not, they're role models. So you have people that's watching them because they're on TV all the time. So whatever they do, you know, kids, then they want to do the same thing, you know. So it's one of the things they got to, like I said, man, they got to look into it, or it's going to get bad.
All right. I've shared my opinion on this before, so I don't need to chime in, but I'm with the rest of you guys. I mean, there's so many different ways you can do this, and what's wrong with the Golden State model? Blow them out in the first half, and we can't say anything if you sit down the rest of the game.
Nope. Yep.
But you're working early.
Matter of fact, we will be saying, all right, that's enough. Sit down.
You know? Yeah, like we're going to tell you, no, Steph, don't do that again.
No,
go sit down. Like, where's Sean Livingston? Exactly. You know, then it's going to be a different type of, you know, that's the kind of conversation you want to have.
And it messes up, the competition. That's where you really see who's great and who's not. The guys that dig deep and still perform when they tired, like, you know. You know, like when Isaiah, when he had a broke foot or whatever, like, or Jordan when he, you know, the flu game or something, you know, game six in 98 when he hit the shot. A lot of people forget Pippen hurt his back. So if he's out most of that game, Jordan was carrying him most of that game. It wasn't, you know, and he's up there in age, you know, even, you know, looking at Jordan and Kareem, they're playing 82 games at 40.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Competing for, you know, well, Jordan wasn't with the Wizards, but, you know, Kareem was competing for a championship. So we're not trying to hit on it. And it was making way less money.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I think the league average now is $5 million. I think Jordan, early on, until his last 3 years, he made, the highest he made was $4 million in the season.
Yeah.
the league averages five. So you got guys sitting on the bench, 12th man, making five mil. Mm-hmm. Not even getting any. Come on, man. We ain't trying to hear all that.
All right, so that's how everybody here, the focus, and our guest, Travis Garrison, feels about the NBA and their resting issue. We got a great show planned for you guys tonight. When we come back from break, we're going to sit here and talk to Mr. Garrison. Going to be a wonderful conversation. After that, we got local coverage, as always. Shout out to Mr. Kavanaugh. Yeah, talk about him just a little bit. We got the Maryland woman to talk about. We got a little DC United.
Destiny.
Then we got another addition to that Pop Your Trunk segment. Yeah. And then of course, what focus show will be complete without that nerve-wracking rapid fire session. And Eddie is not pre-recorded this week. We got a live Petty Eddie this week. So I can only imagine if you thought Rob was geeked up after being off a couple weeks, Petty, this is gonna be crazy later on. So we're gonna take a quick break. You're watching The Focus, and when we get back, we're going to be talking to former DeMatha player, former Maryland Terrapin, Mr. Travis Garrison.
Welcome back to The Focus. As y'all know, we got a special guest, former Jordan Brand, McDonald's All-American, DeMatha, Maryland, Standout. You got a lot of accolades next to that name. You put in work. Travis Garrison, man. So, you know, we going to get right to it as always. Obviously you grew up playing basketball, but, you know, what made you decide on DeMatha?
I tell people this story not all the time, but a lot of people don't know. I didn't know anything about DeMatha before I went to DeMatha. My oldest brother, he played at McNamara, but he's 9 years older than I am. So when I used to go to his games, I was in the hallways running around playing with toys and all this and that. So I wasn't really paying attention to the games. But I was in, I went to Drew Freeman, and I was in the gym one day, and my guidance counselor came in and asked me if I knew anything about DeMatha. He showed me a pamphlet, and I said, no. I know that he said it said a Catholic school on it, and he told me it was all boys school, and I was just like, I was like, man, I don't know. But long story short, he connected it where I went up to DeMatha and I met Coach Wootten. First, when I walked in the office, I saw the trophies, and you know, he kind of gave me the breakdown of all the guys that go to college and the guys that go to pro, that goes pro. But the thing that stood out, what my mom liked, was when he talked about the academics. And how they focus more on grades. And yeah, they're a good sports school, but they make sure that their players get taken care of academically as well. So that's how DeMatha kind of happened. I played in their Christmas tournament in eighth grade, and then after that, it was kind of all there from there. Because my mom didn't want me to go to my local high school. She didn't want me to go to Suitland. My neighborhood was kind of rough at that time, and she just kind of wanted me to get away. I was actually thinking about going to a boarding school. It was like 85 students there. But I didn't get in. But that's how I'm going to DeMatha. So it kind of worked out like that.
That's what's up. The first practice, because you know every level you move up, that first practice is kind of like a shock. It's like, whoa, okay, I need to change this. What was the first practice at DeMatha like?
I think it was during the summertime, it was pickup. Okay. And, you know, you got Keith Bogans, Joe Forte. You know, I'm like, when I was walking, I actually did a shadow and I was walking the halls. And I saw these tall guys. I'm like, I was used to being so tall, the tallest. And you walking up and down DeMatha hallways and you got guys that's 7'2", 7'7", 6'10", 6'9". So I'm like, dang. But that first pickup game, it was definitely an eye-opener for me. The skill level was at a whole nother level. You know, they was number one in the country at the time. So just competing like that and thinking that my game at the time was going to stand out. I don't think I was ranked like number 2 eighth grade in the country at the time. So I kind of walked in like I'm that dude, and you know, kind of got pushed back in my face, you know. Mm-hmm. So I definitely wasn't ready at all, and definitely had to. The way DeMatha works is you have to kind of catch up to the competition. Yep. So you have to work, you know, nothing's given. You have to like really work. So I had to basically step my game up to their level and their expectations. So it was definitely tough at first. It was rough. It was kind of took my confidence a little bit. But as time went on, I kind of gained more confidence and kind of got better as time went on. It was a process.
Okay. You spoke of, you know, Joe Fortin, Keith Bogans. What was the standard that they set, you know, once you got there? Because, you know, like I said, we were the same age. They were all kind of like all world in high school. You know, right. So what was the standard that they said where you know, like, all right, I got to match that real quick?
I talked about it in my book a little bit, but I was playing pickup, and I was on Joe Forte's team. And I was checking Jordan Collins, and Jordan Collins ended up hitting the game winner on me. Mm-hmm. Jordan Collins was 6'10". You know, he was a year ahead of me. But he hit a game winner on me, and we were walking. I'm walking out kind of down a little bit. I'm walking out towards to get some water, and Joe kind of looked back at me and was like, man, you something. And I was like, I'm talking, he had that look in his face like a disgust. And I'm like, and I was, that, I ain't gonna lie, that hurt. You know, I mean, coming from him, and you know, I didn't expect him, but that's just because the way they play and how they work. And like, so basically, like, either you're gonna step up and compete and work hard, and or this ain't for you.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it was like one of them things, you gotta step up or you're gonna get lost. You know, there's been a lot of dudes that wanted to come in there and play. But like I said, the level of expectations was high. They were number one in the country, and they were who they were. Mm-hmm. You know, and they were top 10 in the country as far as players, Joe Forte and Keith. So when you played on their team, you had to, like, work hard, you know, harder than before. So
that misconception, you know, guys saying, man, they just get all the time, the players, and they just roll the balls on, they just win games. That's bogus, that's BS. Man,
look here. I tell guys, I was just talking to one of my old teammates, Corey. He's my best friend, like my best friend. And I was telling the man, like, we used to play this 10 game in practice where the coaches don't call no fouls. Man, I'm talking about, you got dudes out there, man, trying to not clothesline dudes. Man, it was serious, man, because I think the way we competed in practice, it was like everybody wanted to win. It was a competition. Everybody wanted playing time. So you had the A team playing against the B team, but the B team wanted to be on the A team. So, you know, you were literally scratch, I mean, like it was a dog fight in practice. So that's why the games was easier, because we worked so hard in practice. So it was nothing was given. People were like, oh, DeMatha, man, they just because of it. Nah. I know when I was there, we worked. None. And then when I got to a level as far as being the leader on the team, I tried to push myself and be the best player in practice to prove a point, whether we shooting drills or whether we doing sprints. I wanted to be the first because I wanted to prove a point and I wanted to lead by example. So I think that was for all the players, from the last man from the first man to the last man. So we all had the expectations of each other, and we all held each other accountable. You know, our captain was Elijah Brooks, who was the head football coach. Mm-hmm. And, you know, as a football player, you know, he was that dude in football. But he had expectations. So it was like we all held each other accountable, you know. So, I mean, you know, it was, yeah, but none was given. I don't think so.
Morgan Wootten, he's seen as arguably the greatest coach, period, any level. What made him special?
Man, I tell people, man, he's probably one of the greatest people that I ever encountered as far as, okay, you have great coach, but I'm talking like as a person. You know, he used to give different quotes at the beginning of practice, and then at the end of practice, he'd ask us, repeat the quote, or he'd call us, repeat the quote, and then what you think that means. So he talked all about life. And decisions and character, how a good name is better than, you know, than fine riches. Like, basically, how you're supposed to conduct yourself as a person on and off the court. You know, tucking your jersey in. I'm talking from the littlest. I got my first tattoo in high school. I walked into his office, and he kind of, like, looked at me. He was like, you seem a little heavier. And I was like, what you mean? He was like, what's that on your arm? I said that too. He said, well, don't you know that, he said, you know, swimmers, they shave all their hair off for they can be faster. So he's trying to prove a point, but it just goes to show that, you know, he was looking at more of life. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, not just basketball. Yeah, basketball is good, but how you carry yourself. You know, he wasn't big on showboating and things like that, talking trash. You know, he just said, you ain't gonna do all that. Just point to the scoreboard. You know, that do the talking for you. So he was old school, real old school, yeah.
The WCAC, man. A lot of people say it's the top high school basketball conference in the country. How tough was it playing in it? But how tough was it being the top guy on the top team in that league, night in, night out? Because it's different than just being a player in it. You know, you at the top of their scouting report, they coming for you.
Right, right.
If they take you out, they gonna possibly win the game. So how was that? That expectation, that pressure, night in, night out.
I mean, I loved it. I mean, that made me play hard. You know, I had the attitude in high school, whereas I knew dudes was coming at me, so I tried to go at them before they came at me. Mm-hmm. Every team, because we were DeMatha, they wanted to come at us hard. You have players that saying, you know, some games meant more than others for me. You know, I knew, like, for example, I'm going to McNamara. That's around my neighborhood, in a sense. And I know they're going. I already know how they're going to go. And you had the Gonzagas, you know, the Paula Six and things like that. But Joe Forte told me, I think it was Jason Forte, his brother, was like, when you rank that high and you that dudes are going to come at you. So you got to go at them before they come at you. So that was always my mindset, because how hard I worked in high school, that I wasn't going to let nobody outdo me. You know, I try to play my best and do my best. There were times I kind of was trying to play too cool, you know, thinking I was something other than what I was. But other than that, as far as my work ethic, you know, I try to make sure I showed it on the court as well as in practice. So.
Okay. Which program or player during that time gave you the most trouble?
The program, you know, who every time we went to McNamara, we played at McNamara. I don't think I ever won at McNamara when I played varsity.
Oh, wow.
I don't think I ever won there. That was always tough. I think, you know, the ref was kind of a little bit against too. So they always came in there and they play hard and they wanted to prove a point. But I love those games though. Those are the games I love though, you know, because I know it's gonna be a dog fight for real. You know, it's gonna be a lot of trash talking. Like I love, and Kevin Garnett was my man in high school, so I was looking up to Kevin. That was my idol. So anything he was doing, I was like, man, you know, you had, you know, obviously you got the Gonzagas. Those were like the crazy games. You know, the fans go crazy. It's like a Duke and Maryland in a sense. But as far as a player, Calvin Brown was pretty tough in high school too. He was pretty tough in high school too. But I don't know, man. I got to think about that. I never really sat down and thought about.
So you saying you cooked everybody basically?
nah, because there was some dudes that was nice, man. You know, that gave us problems. But like I said, man, I just had that mindset. I just, you know, I ain't played the best defense in the world. You know, we played zone a lot, so that kind of helped me out a lot. But like I said, man, I just try to be the best every time I stepped on the court. I did have some dudes that used to go at me, and it was always a battle. So
matter of fact, speaking of guys going at you, I was telling my young boy, I ran into Raymond Felton, five star, and like in 10th grade or whatever, and you know all the coaches was surrounding him. I'm like, who's it? And then when I saw him play, I was like, I thought he was going to be the next Steve Francis.
Yeah.
They didn't believe he played like that. I'm like, no, he had bounce. So I put a clip up, and then I think your teammate Corey, he spoke on it. He was like, man, he gave us the business down in
South Carolina.
Yeah, down in South Carolina. Classic. And that's what really put him on the map, where it was like, all right, North Carolina, everybody really just started. Because he gave y'all nothing. He was like, man, we couldn't do nothing with him. So, I mean, talk about that experience because, you know, I'm pretty sure, I mean, you probably knew he was good, maybe like a nice local player, but he made that leap nationally. He ain't looked back since.
Yeah, because when I went down, I didn't really know anything about Raymond. I think they gave us a scouting report, but I said they got a kid, you know, that's pretty good or whatever. And I think he probably was the tallest dude on the team, maybe. He was the tallest guy on the team. He was like 6'3", 6'4". So that was our first game. And we ended up losing to him. That was like the biggest upset in baseball classic history.
Oh, wow.
So our coach was hot after that. But, you know, I was sick. I had the flu and I had the stomach virus. But obviously my coach was like, yo, you playing. But I was, man, I had the stiff stuff up my nose. Like, it was crazy, man. But they ended up beating us. And it was the biggest talk of the tournament. But that did put him on the mat because he had like 30-something, I think, like 32, I believe. But, yeah, that's when I kind of figured out who he was, you know.
You didn't go – we spoke before in the interview. You said you didn't play AAU. You know, you had to handle academic stuff. You didn't really have a chance to go to elite camps until before your senior year. Going to your senior year, you went to probably the most hyped up ABCD camp that they might have had ever, and that was the Lenny Cook versus LeBron, you know, deal. First of all, from your perspective, what was your mindset going in individually as a player? And also, you know, you saw the matchup with Lenny and Carmelo up close, and then the infamous game where LeBron went from just a nice and local regional player to you know, taking him out and becoming the number one player regardless of class, and then it sparked to where he is now. You know, talk about all that.
Basically, yeah, most of the time. I did play AAU a little bit. During the summer, I didn't have a chance to really go to any tournaments or any things like that because I didn't take school very serious and during the school year. So every summer, I was in summer school trying to make up for grades. And like I got invited to USA, a thing up in Colorado. Coach was like, nope, can't go to that. But going into my senior year, because I thought it was important for me to, if I wanted to make the McDonald's All-American game, that I had to prove, not just locally, but nationally against the best players. So my mindset going in was, I want to kill everybody there. Like, I want to be one of the best players coming out of ABC to Canada. Like, that was my goal going into it. So I already knew what I was going to do because I knew how much work I put in going into that because that was my first camp I ever went to. And I wanted to be in the McDonald's All-American and play against the best and prove that. Because all these scouts used to always say, like, well, how you plan to make the McDonald's All-American game if you ain't really traveling or if nobody can see you? You know, we hear about what you're doing at DeMatha, but you're not doing against the best players. So I was like, all right, you know. And on my team, my first game, it was me, Melo, Azubuki that went to Kentucky, Chris Taft that was at Pittsburgh, another kid from Baltimore. Now, my man, his name is Kenny. I think he played at Hosford. I forget where he played at. And our coach was Wilkerson or Williams, who was, I think he's like a scout for the Knicks. Crazy guy, man. But great dude. But that's when Melo, because I knew Melo when he was a sophomore, and he was like top 100. And then that summer he grew. And then he just became that dude. He was in the gym. And then he just started really working. He started moving up through the ranks. But going into the ABCD camp, everybody kept saying, who's better, him or Lenny Cook? Him or Lenny Cook? So Melo came in. Melo came in. That was our first game. And, man, you already knew that was his mission, like, to try to prove a point. And he did. Like, him and Lenny was going at it, but Melo got the best of him, you know. And then Melo left the camp. That was his first and last game. So he basically came in, proved a point, and got out of there. But he did what he came. He came to prove a point and got out of there. Yeah, so that's what he did. But I ain't mad at him. And then as far as LeBron, I didn't even know who LeBron was because we were traveling to different states to play nationally when I was with DeMatha. And we was in the airport one time. I think we was in Ohio. And stuff. You playing against that kid from St. Vincent? I was like, who are you talking about? I don't know who you're talking about. Everybody kept talking about them. So when I saw him at ABCD camp, I didn't really know anything about him. We played against him. I still kind of didn't really know. And then people started like kind of hyping him and talking about him. And then when him and Lenny went at it, I was actually playing the court next to us. And we used to have a lot of scouts and everybody at our games, but everything kind of shifted to the middle court. So it wasn't nobody. I'm like, man, what's going on? Then I came in and I walked over there, man, yeah. So they were going at it, man. You know, obviously that's where LeBron, I think, kind of really skyrocketed, especially when he went at Lenny and they kind of was battling and, you know, he did his thing. And then that's when it, you know, because he had this little bush and everything. Yeah. It was all crazy. And then after that, I think got the cut. That's when everything kind of shifted. It's marketing time, man. Time for marketing. So,
LeVar Ball move.
Then, so that was a great camp, man. I really enjoyed it. It was funny because Daniel Horton and Chris Bosh was trying to recruit me to go to Michigan. Mm-hmm. And the funny thing is, Chris Bosh went to Georgia Tech. Exactly. So they were trying to like, oh, man, come on, we all go down to Michigan, man. We all go to Michigan. And I was like, yeah. So, but that's why it's funny that Chris Bosh and I'm going to Georgia Tech. I ended up making an all-star game down there, but come playing it because I was going to miss, I already missed like 3 days of summer school, couldn't miss no more. Had to go back. So I was like, man, like learning lessons all through, man. Like I couldn't even play in the all-star. Like that was one of the best all-star because LeBron, Telfair, all those guys was in it. I couldn't even play in it, man, because I had to go back to summer school. So that's what I tell kids now, man. You got to take care of them books, man. Yeah. I know my coach ain't play that. You can't do nothing. Nah, no. I was like, man, so.
Speaking of Georgia Tech and Michigan, man, what were some of the schools that recruited you, and why did you choose Maryland?
A lot of schools recruited me, but after doing ABCD camp, more schools really went hard at me. I know Patino, like, called my hotel room a few times. But, you know, you got the Dukes, the North Carolina. I thought about going to Duke for a second because I was like, man, I was into like, oh, man, I want to take care of these, get this academic, go to good school for academics and things like that. Then I thought about Seton Hall because Tommy Amaker was there. Mm-hmm. And I loved that dude, man. Great coach, great person. And then I saw what Eddie Griffin was doing up there. Yeah, he was one and done. Then, you know, I thought about Georgia Tech and Notre Dame for a second. I chose Maryland because I saw what Terrence Morris did, and it was close by. You know, actually, for a minute, I wasn't thinking about Maryland. I was like, man, I can't do it. Gary yelling too much. I can't do that, man. Like, and I was telling people, I said, I'm not. People like, man, you gonna go to Maryland? I said, I'm not going to Maryland. I'm not going to Maryland. But just being there, be home. My mom, like, I was looking at Michigan because Tommy Amcare ended up going to Michigan. And she was just like, how long is the drive? And it was like 15 hours. And she was like, man, like. So I thought that came into play, too. Good thing I kind of didn't go to Michigan because the whole NCAA violation thing, they couldn't play. So that was one of my main decisions, going to Maryland. It's close by home and, you know, just stay by. And then, like I said, I seen what Terrence Morris did. And, you know, they recruited me real heavy. North Carolina tried to come in there. They was recruiting me at one point, then they stopped. Then, like, that summer, going to my senior year, they, like, called me, like, you know, what about North Carolina? I was like, I already kind of got my five to schools, and they were like, but we're in North Carolina. Like, you don't know who y'all were in North Carolina. I'm like, nah, man. I already, because it was, I ain't going to lie, man, I wasn't prepared for that process. My mom wasn't prepared, because they were calling, like, they was finding all ways to get in contact, man, and it was overwhelming. It was times I, like, didn't even go home and left my cell phone there just because the calls were crazy, then the mail and stuff. So I like used to have to get away and go to people's houses just like to get away. But that's why I chose Maryland, man. I'm kind of glad I did. It was a learning process for me as well, and you know, it worked out.
Okay. How much fun was it being the McDonald's All-American, Jordan Brand All-American? Because you know, I know the first time I saw Jordan, I'm a grown man, so the first time I saw Jordan at the Jordan Classic, yeah, when he walked past, man, I got stuck a little bit. I was like, yo, this is the GOAT, man. So I can only imagine, you know, being a teenager, man. Like, so how was the experience, man?
It was interesting, man. I end up, I was real close with Darius Miles at the time.
Okay.
And I end up, I seen Jordan during our season when I was in high school. Like, I met him. But I was a big fan of Kevin Garnett, man. Like, I was just like, so, like, you know what I mean? Yeah, that's Michael Jordan, and, you know, and don't get me wrong, I know that's the GOAT, that's that dude, but I was like, man, where KG at? You know what I'm saying? So I met him there. It was super dope, man. It was a surreal feeling. And then when I met him at the Capital Classic for it, and I tell people now with the picture, I ain't even smiling, and I regret that now, because that's like a moment, man. Mm-hmm. You with that dude,
right?
So, but I definitely was grateful for it, man. Even been a McDonald's All-American, you know, a lot of people say this and that. I know I worked for it. You know, it wasn't given. You know, yeah, I know who my coach was, but I know how much work I put in. And then, you know, playing with the guys like Melo and Amari, seeing that dude now. Yeah, that's when I was going. I came back after the McDonald's All-American game. I came back home. I said, look here, Amari Stoudemire, he's not going to college. And they was like, who? I said, man, a dude from Florida, he's not going to college, man. And they was like, man, I don't know. I said, man, okay, he's going to go top 10, easy. And people ain't understand what I was saying, because I was at practice, man, and he was grown man out there. I'm talking like, when I say, like, killing them, dude, I'm talking, it was, you could see the difference. And these are the top dudes in the country. He was killing them, man. And we were on a bus one time, and we were going to a dinner, and Amari like, hey, bro, I ain't going to school. You know, I'm going to kill this. I'm going to kill Tim Duncan. I'm going to kill I'm better than Chris Wilcox. Like, I'm going to kill this. And dudes are kind of like, metal. Everybody kind of like looking like, yeah, all right. But like, he was like, man, because he was reading the report what Bob Givens said about him. Like, he was talented but with no skills or something like that. Bro, and like, yeah, he was like, hot. He was like, man, you see this, man? You see this? And he's like, man, watch. Watch when I get to the league. Watch. So dudes is like kind of like looking, but man, his first year he averaged 40 against San Antonio.
Man, look,
he was killing, man.
He bodied both of them.
Yeah, caught man, both of them. He got my man KG too.
Caught the twin.
That's
towers.
What Marbury was like.
Caught them both.
That's what Marbury was like, man. He better than KG. And then KG got mad. He's like, man, get off his.
I remember that.
They was beefing. And this is a true story. We played in the AAU tournament down in North Carolina, and we got through playing, and then. The word is, you know, back then it wasn't social media, so a lot of stuff shot word of mouth. You would hear about players like who, but you couldn't really see unless they was on a show or something. So we they like, this kid, he gonna be number one pick. Amari, he's about to play. He from, you know, Florida. Yeah. So I was like, he's like, who is that? So we literally walked past the team that they was about to play, and they sent it. I saw the coach, Manonas. He was like, "You got Amari," and the kid was like, he got shook on the spot. And we was like, so we like, why he shook? So everybody, like you said, everybody grabbed to us, went to the gym when they about to play. I think Mar had like 20 or 20 in the first half. And it was all dunks. Like, he was a beast, man. Like, dudes was shook at him. And I understand why, because the physicality, unless you just blessed, you know, early on, like a Chris Webber or him, something like that, you don't get that till you get to college when you on that regimen. He had that naturally.
Man, he was that dog. I saw him a few years ago. We were talking about it. I said, man, remember that time we had that conversation on the bus, man? You said how you was going to kill X, Y, Z? He was like, yeah, man. I said, man, because he was, like I said, I came back home. I said, dude, look here. Dude is going lotto. He going to go top 10, man. Watch what I tell you. He going to kill it. Because he was hungry, man.
Yeah,
he was literally hungry. Like, you could see it in his face and growling. Like, he was
I remember D'Angelo Collins was like, I'm better than Amari, man.
They were going on that in the practice. And, like, because the way D'Angelo was, if you know him, like, the way he was just like, because I think MTV was following him, doing some type of thing, documentary or reality show on him. So how he was carrying himself and acting, Amari was just like, Amari real chill. He a cool, real good dude. Like, but he's like, he'd treat you like his little brother in the sense, the way he carried himself. And he was just like, man, this dude, man. Like, he was just getting on his nerves. And Amari was trying to chill, like, I'm chilling, and D'Angelo just kept messing with him.
Yeah, to give it to him. So, how much pressure was it on you guys? You came in that great class of Maryland, you, McCray, Nick Cannamelli, Jones, and Gilchrist.
Mm-hmm.
How much pressure was it on y'all to kind of build off that national championship coming into Maryland?
It was a lot. I didn't understand the responsibility that, you know, I had, that we had, because they just won the national championship. So, because they went to Final Four the year before, and they went to the national championship. So, they, like, we expect, this is a great class, so they expecting us to continue the legacy and go on. But I know for me, personally, I wasn't ready for that type of life, you know, because I was in DeMatha, man. Oh, it was all hoops, and I go back home. I wasn't really doing too much. Then I go up to Maryland when they just won a national championship. I'm from the area. I start experiencing the college life, the club life, the girl, I mean, everything. Like, it was all like, I was like, man, it was like a kid that's never been out before. And then, so I kind of got, I ain't gonna lie, I got wrapped up and caught up in that world, man, of who I was. So I always kind of carry, like, I'm Travis Garrison, McDonald's All-American. So I thinking that your name gonna carry the weight through that. And right. That's not gonna happen, because you see a lot of dudes that came in that was, how they recruited, you know, Shavlik Randolph was how they recruited a guy. He didn't really play that much at Duke like that. He ended up getting in the league, but not really working, man, and putting that effort in. You got guys that actually worked and put that work in and then end up making it. You know, Jerry Jack wasn't a McDonald's All-American, but he got in that league, and he's still in the league.
Yes.
You know, so you got dudes that, Andre Iguodala.
Yeah.
I ain't really know him until the Jordan game, and this dude's still in the league. So you had these guys, J.J. Redick, but you had these guys who probably wasn't highly recruited, or you didn't really expect it, but they worked their butts off in college, and they put that work in, where the other guys kind of like wanted to live off their name or reputation and think it's going to carry them through, and it don't happen like that.
Okay. Mr. Gary Williams, man. How was it like playing for him, man?
It was interesting. You know, I kind of knew what I was going to get before I even got there anyway, because I went to a few practices, and I went to a few of the Maryland games, so I kind of seen how he acted. A lot of people don't really understand him because he's not real talkative. He's not real social. You know, he's that dude that's going to be up in here. He's sitting over there in the corner. You know what I mean? Because he's not real sociable. But, like, behind the scenes, man, real good dude, man, you know, makes jokes, you know, really cares about you. You know, I didn't appreciate that when I was there either, because I wanted it this way. He wanted it that way. I thought I knew what I was doing, and, you know, and he wanted what was best for me. But I didn't see that at the time. You know, I'm like, yo, I thought I was coming in here and play the three. You got me playing the five. You know, but he's like, yo, you know, you need to learn both parts. You know what I mean? That's going to make you a better player.
Right.
But I'm not saying that, because I have people in my ear like, dude, you need to go somewhere where you can play 3-4, because that's what's going to get you in the league, and that's who you are, that's the kind of player you are. And I wasn't skilled as a big man as far as in the post or anything like that. but he was trying to make me that. He was trying to make me do both, you know, inside and outside. Yeah, but I didn't see that, though, because I'm, you know, hard-headed, you know what I mean? I end up learning the hard way, but I appreciate him more now. Like, I see him now, I'm like, man, you know, I think it's been a while now. I ain't go back to Merlin because I felt some sort of way towards him. Mm-hmm. But then I end up realizing, especially when I did the book, I ended up realizing a lot of the things that happened was my fault, and he was really trying to help. So I ended up like writing him I ended up apologizing, like sending him a long text message, and he ended up hitting me back. And so now when we see each other, it's like a better rapport between us. So yeah, you know, he's one of those dudes, man. He gonna fight for you, and you know, if you work with him, you know, he wants what's best for you. But you know, he's different, but real good dude.
Man, that's a good story, because a lot of youngers need to hear that. They don't like coaching these days, and ironically, he was right. He kind of saw what the league was becoming, the stretch forward and Kevin Love moment. I always say your game is kind of similar to his. Mm-hmm. Watching you in high school and college, like, you know, that could have easily been you. He was trying to mold you. So, yeah, all you had to do, you just listen. Just simple, just, okay, coach, I'm going to do it. Even if you don't understand, I'm going to do it. I trust you. Now youngers do that, and it's crazy. But they know any younger.
Man, I'm like, man, how I look at things now and seeing all that I saw and, you know, things I could have done if I would have just, you know, worked harder, focused more, lead the clubs, lead the girls, lead the drinking, all that stuff alone. I could have maximized my potential, God-given talent and my potential and the skills that I already had, and could have probably been in the league now or still in the league or whatever. But because I didn't do that, or try to wait too late to do that, you know, it was a cautionary tale. But now when I go back and I use that story and those experiences, all the good, all the bad, to help younger players and other parents who may not be aware of the business side of things. Because it's a business.
Yep.
You got guys out there that ain't for these kids. So that's why it's like, you know, I retired early because I felt it was my obligation. I kind of got what I wanted out of basketball as a player. So now what can I do with this bunch of stuff over here, the good, the bad, all this experiences? How can I help other people, other parents, other kids? Help them try to make better decisions, because some people just don't know. I didn't know until I went through it.
Right.
So.
A highlight of your career at Maryland was the ACC Tournament Championship against Duke. I think you dropped 19 points and 7 rebounds on them in that game, and it was like the first ACC title since, what, the 80s, mid-80s? 84, or
it's 20 years.
But y'all run there was unlike, because y'all was the 6th seed. Y'all beat the top 3 seed. Y'all beat 3rd seed with Wake Forest.
Wake Forest, North Carolina State. Yeah, and then Duke.
That's
yeah.
A hell.
That's a big
and Greensboro, the real traditional ACC. That was a hell of a run, and you capped it off with that great performance in that championship game, man. Like, yo, just talk about that, because I know that was like
whirlwind. That right there, I tell people a lot of times, most of my college career was kind of like a blur to me, because I don't think I was, you know, who I am now, or, you know, I wasn't really like there mentally, but that run right there, man, I know what I did before that tournament, because I was going through depression at that time. Like, I was the one that reading the blogs and seeing what people were saying about me and news clippings, and you know, I was very like in my head, so I was trying to like please everybody,
right?
And so I wasn't happy, man. There'd be times like I just wasn't happy. So I ended up watching one of my old high school games and seeing how happy I was, and it was just like I was just out there having fun. And I believe we played NC State before we went out there. So before we went to the tournament, they were like, you know, we were on a bubble. So we maybe beat Wake Forest, then we might have a chance. And I think at NC State we were down, and we had a habit of being down in the first half and trying to come back in the second half. Because we were young. We were all sophomores, and we had Jamar Smith, who was a senior. But we would always try to rally back. So I think we played NC State, and we just kind of just played. Like, we didn't run the flex or anything. We just played. And then we end up coming back and winning. And then we end up going to Wake Forest, and kind of coach was kind of like, we kind of had the attitude like, yo, we just go out here and hoop. Forget everything else, hoop. That's what Coach Williams said. He was like, man, just go out there, have fun, and play. And we did, man. I think we didn't run the flex. We ran 4-out-1-in. And, like, that's when it all started, man. We played Chris Paul and them, got them out of there. We were down 20 against NC State. Man, people thought that we were done. And John Gilchrist, man.
Yeah, he went off.
Man, look here. It was like, man, all right, get the ball to John. Get the ball to John. Because I'm talking about, like, we were down in the first half by 20. But we had the attitude, like, man, we've been like this before. We good. Like, so we ain't think nothing about it. We good.
Right.
And John was just on a whole different world, man. Like, he was just like he was in a zone. And he basically won that game for us. Then it comes Duke, and at that time, they were like, we're in the tournament, we're good. But we're like, man, let's go ahead and just let's get it. And like so that run, man, it was amazing, man. It was, like I said, probably one of the best experiences at Maryland. Just that whole experience and what it meant. And you know, I go back up to Maryland now, and people always talking about, like, man, we remember that run, ACC tournament. You know what I mean? Because what we had to do to get it. You know, we ended up getting a 4 seed after we beat Duke, too. Like, so we ended up going from the bubble to getting a 4 seed in the tournament. So it was definitely a memorable moment. my mom recorded all the games. I still have yet to watch. I think I probably watched a little bit of the Duke game before because they run it back sometimes during tournament time. But it was a great moment, man, just how the fans was reacting and everything from the game to the phone calls to when we got back here. You know, it was nuts, man. It was definitely like a great moment for me. And I mean, I hope it lives on for a while because it's something, you know. I mean, like I said, they didn't win the ACC tournament 20 years before that. Yeah. And then, like I said, what it meant to people as far as getting to the tournament and what we had to overcome. It was unbelievable, man. I loved it. You know, like I said, I talk about that all the time.
No doubt. You went undrafted, played in the CBA, then you went overseas. For the younger guys coming up looking to get an opportunity overseas and whatnot, what are the pros and cons of playing in, you know, the minor leagues and the professional leagues across the water?
Before I went over there, people was talking about going overseas and this and the third, and I thought it was disrespectful because I didn't know anything about overseas, and my whole mindset was NBA. Obviously, I didn't do enough to get drafted, or, you know, I waited too late. I ended up dropping off my second semester of my senior year and working my way to get into Portsmouth. I didn't even get invited to Portsmouth. I had to work my way to get in Portsmouth. But I said, once I get in, I'm going to try to prove a point and let everybody know that I can play in the league. So I put myself back on the map as far as trying to have an opportunity. So they was predicting late second round, but then I got in trouble in college, so I had to go to court 2 days before the draft. So all the teams that were calling, they stopped calling. Because I didn't have a great college career. So I'm not a person they could take a gamble on because I didn't have no name like that. Yeah, they knew who I was, but I ain't doing nothing in college. So I understood it. ended up getting drafted by the Lakers D-League team. So they took a chance. But the coach, man, you know, it didn't work out. Ended up going to the CBA because they thought I still can probably have an opportunity to make a team or get called up or, you know, teams could see me. So I made rookie of the year that year, and I ended up coming back and working out for the Sixers and then going to Cleveland's mini camp. And then I ended up going to South Korea, and then that was my first experience going overseas. My first experience is a little different than others because some people start off a little slow. Like I went to South Korea, and the amount of money they were paying, that's not the normal amount some rookies get now. You know? Right. Because like, if you're going to, like, friend, you're a rookie, you're going to friend, like some guy's not making that much money. Asia is a little different. So mine was like a rare situation, but it's definitely life-changing, you know. It was a great experience for me. I learned so much, and I'm actually grateful that I went overseas because I, you know, South Korea, Spain, Venezuela, Turkey, Greece, Ukraine, Lithuania, Bahrain. So I got all these experiences in different cultures, and you know, I got so used to living overseas that being back here is awkward for me, in a sense. I was just telling you, Cardell, like, it's different for me now. This is probably the longest I've actually been home since college, and it's an adjustment because I'm used to living overseas, and I actually sometimes like it better because it's a different way of living. You know, you learn different cultures. I have different friends over there, speak a different language. Some people can't adjust to that. I've been over there with players that just can't deal with the food. They can't deal with the people. They don't want to adjust to their way of life, whereas they actually embrace you more when you just try. Mm-hmm. So I learned to kind of like the survival of the fittest. So every environment I was put in, I kind of adapted to that. A lot of players can't do that. You got dudes that's in the league that go over there, they can't do it because you live in a different world. You might not have the people that you know. So some people could do it, and some people, they just ain't made for it. Like I said, you got league dudes that go over there, and they just can't because it's a different playing style, maybe more physical than the league is now because you're getting a hand check. Whereas some of these leagues over there, you might lose some teeth. Like broke. It's crazy, man. But for the younger players, it's just, man, I tell kids now, man, go for that money. I know you want to get in the league. Some dudes turn down big money, man, because I get the dream. If you're young enough, yeah, take that risk. But after a couple of years, get that money, because the way things are now, they're not. It's not the same. You know, the money is not the same. The opportunities, they want to pay less. The economy's changed. So I'm kind of glad I caught it when I could. Even over there, man, I was kind of like, just like, I know my first year, I went to South Korea, went to Spain, left Spain. I was just kind of bouncing around, so I kind of got a little reputation to bounce around, because I felt as though I'm not happy here, so I want to go somewhere else.
Right.
And they don't know that people talk, and you have a resume. It's like a job. Mm-hmm. What do you need a job for? So they're making calls. Why this? Why that? So I'll tell kids now, man, just enjoy your life. That's a people. You don't have to, like, they actually bringing you over there, paying for your living, giving you tax-free money. Like, enjoy the moment. And if you're good enough, the NBA going to find you, because it's global now. So it's not about, nah, I want to leave. Not, man, go get that money. If you're good enough, they'll know, because a lot of guys did it already. They went over there, played a few years, and come back. Now they got a 3-year guaranteed contract for X amount of money, or they're good enough so they have NBA scouts over there, or people talk. And if you're kidding, wherever you at, even in colleges, people want big-name colleges. Man, if you're good, you're good. Mm-hmm. Kawhi Leonard, yeah. Steph, Davidson. You know what I mean? Like, so, you know, if you can play, you can play.
All right, well, Travis, we just want to thank you for a wonderful conversation. You're not leaving yet. We still got rapid fire to go through. We're going to take a quick break when we get back. Going to little local coverage and jump straight into rapid fire. You guys are watching The Focus. Welcome back to The Focus. Wonderful conversation with Mr. Travis Garrison. Okay, guys, we had a lot going on in terms of local coverage this week. As we always tell you guys, there's two wonderful places you can find all of this content. Finestmagazine.com, aka finestmag.com. Follow Cardell all across social media. He was at the 30 by 30 last week, and that was something that was put on by Mr. Ricky Goins. He was a guest of maybe a month ago on The Focus. So again, we're tying things together. Head over there and check that out. Also, GW, you've heard Tyler Cavanaugh's name, I think, like, consistently since the show started on here on DCTV. So I need you to do me a favor, give it a Finest Mag, and check out the end of his career at GW, his wonderful career. And we've heard Cardell say many times that the kid has a future in the league. So we're going to pay attention over the next couple months, because eventually, you know, after playoffs are done, we already heard Sport Smith mentioned once on this show. It might be a place that Tyler ends up on his journey to the NBA. As for us, we had a lot going on. We had DC United, most importantly, Maryland women's basketball. They advanced to the Sweet 16. We were there for the first two rounds of coverage. We got like 11 interviews up there right now. So we got a lot of content over there. Get over there, check that out. Get over to YouTube and search Finest Mag. Get over to YouTube, also search My Model Sports. And that'll get you all caught up over the past week in local coverage from both the respective powers here at The Focus. Travis, before we jump into the Pop Your Trunk State segment, which I'm so happy about this week, because I think it was a no-brainer. When he hit me, I was just like, yeah, I didn't have to argue anything. But Travis, tell him, you mentioned your book several times, man. Tell him how they can get a hand on your book.
You get my book at neversatisfiedtg.info. The title of the book is Never Satisfied, An Athlete's Battle. And it's also on Amazon as well. So it's neversatisfiedtg.info, and then it's also on Amazon. So.
All right, guys, please go check that out. It's definitely worth your time and definitely worth the read. So, pop the trunk, Cardell.
Hey, man. Maryland freshman female.
I get to. Hey.
Destiny Slocum, man.
Miss Slocum. Yeah. And it was the craziest thing in the world. Jarell and I were like 5 feet away when she did this. Mm-hmm. So Travis took a picture. I'm going to show you guys a picture after the show's over. And he caught us in the celebration shot, because we were both geeking over the fact that that happened. Like, I fully haven't accepted that I saw it, and I don't watch SportsCenter. I have in a few years. I did at least get on Twitter to check SportsCenter's to make sure that it was. I didn't want to make sure they put some respect on it, and it was on the top 10. I've never seen somebody throw, like, it was a soccer style throw in for 65 feet with the defender on her. It was amazing. And again, we got more Destiny Slocum stuff over at My Mono Sports, along with the rest of the Maryland Terrapins that are headed to Connecticut this week, as we are, for the Sweet 16 and the Elite Eight. So keep up with us here at The Focus. We got a lot of good stuff coming for you this upcoming week. Without further ado, Cardell, the floor is yours with the rapid fire segment.
All right. No, first question. With Washington not making the tournament, has that taken Markelle Fultz out of the number one pick consideration for you guys? We're going to start with the fellow marathon guy.
I don't think so. I think all the hype is, it is what it is. The kid can play. I don't think it has. I don't think it would affect anything at all, to be honest, because I think they already knew what was what. They already knew what the team was, what it was, and you know that's why he ain't playing no more. He's like, I'm good. So.
Yeah, I agree. Basically, took all the words out of my mouth. I say the exact same thing because it's like if you can play, you can play. Mm-hmm. Point blank, period.
I mean, I'm sure they're gonna start the whole conversation because that's
what they
do in this culture. But don't take them if you want to. That's on you.
Hold on. Should the NBA start taking game checks from players who sit out games and aren't injured?
I agree.
I'm asking. You agree?
Yeah,
They should
do something. I don't know if it should be that drastic. I think it should be just to send a message. Mm-hmm. Know that this isn't something that we're going to play around with. You know, if y'all are getting paid all this money for playing, mm-hmm. then you don't get money when you don't play if there's not something physically wrong with you. Like, we always, you know, understand if they're hurt, if it's lingering injuries and things like that.
Right.
But if you're just telling me, I'm a little bit tired today, I think I'll take a break. You know, your paycheck will take a break too.
I'm with Octavia.
I think they do the same. I was thinking that actually when y'all first was talking about that when I first came in. Like, you know, don't they do that at your regular job? Like, if you don't come in, you don't get paid that day, right?
Back
you
pay.
That is very true.
Okay. Should the NFL do away permanently with Thursday night games?
Yes, it's bad for the players physically. And it's bad for us to watch, so how about we just skip it? It's horrible to look at.
Yeah, I can go, you know, I guess I can go without it as well, you know.
I'm a little 50-50 just because I like football. Like, Sunday be so far away after Sunday happens, and then Monday night happens, and I got to go all week again until I can watch it again.
But how many times did you turn on your TV on Thursday night and turn it back off?
Depends on who was playing. Now, some of the Thursday night games weren't that interesting, so those we could have skipped.
Okay.
But if it's a good game, you know, especially because I like an out-of-market team, so if they're playing it on there, it's kind of helpful. But, I mean, as far as the regimen is them, you know, playing, you know, they do play a more physical game than basketball, of course. Not saying basketball's not physical, but I get it because it gives them a shorter week. They still have to travel longer periods of time and stuff like that. So I'm kind of good either way, although I like the extra day of sports. Just okay. Me.
How is Maryland women's center Breonna Jones not a Naismith finalist?
Sounds like hate to me.
Politics as usual. She's the best big in the country, hands down. And all I got to say is when you have to take three people to box somebody out, don't take them off your ward list. Come on, man.
What he said.
Yeah.
Like, literally, there was three people in West Virginia assigned to box one player out. But you going to take her name off the list?
Come on. Okay. Thoughts on the protesters flying a Confederate flag outside the NCAA tournament venue?
America?
It's sad to say it's becoming the norm.
Yeah.
That's the sad part. But I guess if it goes back to this whole free speech thing, you know, I guess. But it's not a good look.
Yeah. The way things are these days, you know, I mean, nothing surprises me now, which is sad.
Yeah.
You know, nothing surprises me anymore, so.
Okay. The FBI got involved with helping to find Tom Brady's missing Super Bowl jerseys.
And they found it.
Shouldn't the feds be focused on something more important, like, you know, missing girls around this area? So much other things to be worried about.
Yeah, I mean, they found it in Mexico, and they brought it back to him. It's like they gave it his own little entourage back to him. I mean, I get it. It was probably very important to him, but I'm pretty sure he could have hired somebody else to go do that while the FBI handles things that the FBI is supposed to handle, you know, that kind of would have been cool.
What she said.
Yeah, I feel the same way. I know D.L. Hughley posted something about that, and, you know, that is interesting. You know, you have all these teens, you know. I have a daughter, so, and I have kids, too, so, you know, definitely I feel a little different. You know, I feel some way about it. But, you know, people focus more on things that's, I mean, I ain't saying it's meaningless, but, you know, there's more important things that they could be worrying about right now as well, so.
Notre Dame point guard Lizzie Allen. She's the best point guard prospect since your fellow UConn great Sue Bird.
Yes.
If he say yes, I say yes. Because I know he know.
I think she's almost as flawless a prospect as Sue was.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah, she's
tough. I really think she's that. Like, Sue's like, ideally, men's or women's the epitome of a perfect point guard. Mm-hmm. Ideally, yeah.
and being from the area, she don't get the pub she deserves, man. She's like flawless.
She definitely doesn't deserve it. I mean, she definitely doesn't get what she deserves. Okay. Yeah, nah, she's the best.
Okay. UCLA versus Kentucky in the Sweet 16 Friday. Will Lonzo Ball solidify himself as the top pick if he leads the Bruins over Kentucky? Don't all speak at once.
I mean, to me, I'm indifferent. Like, whoever wins, it is what it is. Like, I'm not going to hold you beating Kentucky higher than I hold Fultz not being in the tournament. Mm-hmm. If, you know, if I like you as a prospect, like, I just don't care. So, should I think less of Jason Tatum because they're not in the tournament anymore? You know, so I mean, just like, again, this is one of those hot take things for me. So if you like the kid, you're going to take him.
Sure.
Yeah, I agree too. I think Isaiah Thomas already kind of made a point. I mean, he kind of expressed how he felt about that. So you got to go with the star player.
Donald Trump took credit for Colin Kaepernick not being signed. Thoughts on that?
Ignorance.
I don't even have words. We talk about the FBI doing stuff they're supposed to be doing. Shouldn't he be doing some other stuff instead of worrying about Colin Kaepernick and all this other stuff?
Fake news.
Like, that's, how about you focus on being the president? Let's do that.
My words are not suitable for this program.
You won't get his banned. Yeah. That's it for y'all. That's it. We're going to keep it short.
All right, y'all. Well, we want to thank you guys for tuning in this week. Got a lot more planned next week. We'll have some. We're going to try to have some content from Bridgeport.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm not going to make any promises because I don't know what type of health I'm going to be in.
We're going to have this zombies time next week, guys. We're going to have zombies.
But Travis, thank you so much, man. It's always good to have you around. Thank you so much for coming in.
No, I appreciate it, man. I appreciate the opportunity, to be honest, man. Like I said, man, I'm happy for you guys. You guys have been grinding, you know, and I just appreciate the opportunity. I appreciate what you guys do for this area, and keep doing what you're doing.
Thank you so much for the kind words, and we'll see everybody next week, same time, same place, right here. Thanks, folks.